My guest is a French-British pianist, composer, and singer-songwriter. He has been performing popular music, jazz, and his first love, classical music. He enjoys regular guest appearances worldwide and has been recording, arranging, and collaborating with, among others, cellist Julian Lloyd Webber, playwright Tom Stoppard, Ronnie Wood, Dustin Hoffman and Michael Gambon, and singer Elena Page, and was also guest artist at Princess Margaret's birthday. He's also an enthusiastic chess player and has campaigned to promote the game among young people and, in particular, young women. In fact, he has combined his passion for the game with his love of music, which has earned him the title Chess Maestro. He is Jason Kouchak.
Thanks very much.
Jason, welcome to Extraordinary People. I'm particularly interested in combining the music, the chess, you know, your opinion about life, etc. But first of all, your genes.
These genes are very special because 64 squares, patches, and they bring me luck. And it's 8x8, so you have do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, do, 8 notes, and you have the, in chess, the 8 squares by 8. So 64 squares bring me luck wherever I go, and I hope we'll have a lucky day today.
Right, well, I'm sure we will. So you went to the tailor and said, I want 64 patches on my jeans.
I want 64 patches.
How superstitious are you?
Very much so. I mean, even today, being in Brighton is so lovely. The sun just came through the clouds and brought luck to us.
Right, okay. So you're an optimist. I you know, I have met you before. I can sense that. One thing that stuck in my mind from our previous conversation, you play the piano, but you do not believe in following the score, the music score. You're not the only pianist who doesn't, but you feel that it's a matter of kind of principle nearly. And you said to me, you know, the ones who do are lazy. And what's important for me is to have this kind of link with the audience, the eye contact, the rapport.
Yes.
How important is it for you to kind of to be in touch with the people that you perform for?
I think it's very important. I think if you're using music for performance, you're creating a boundary, a wall. And without the music in front of you, you're able to absorb almost a spiritual link from the composer to the audience. And the audience really should have that. They deserve that when you're performing.
Right. Aren't you compromising in a sense your, perhaps your sincere attitude to the music by thinking about the people while doing your art, really?
I don't think so much of the word thinking, it's more feeling the frequencies from the audience. You have a feedback, the wavelengths from various parts of the audience, and as you're performing, you feel it.
Okay. So your first love, classical music. You were born in France.
Yes.
Your mother is British, your father French.
Yes.
Singer, he was a singer as
yes.
well.
Yes.
When did you discover that you were a little pianist? How was little Jason?
Well, little Jason would listen to mummy play the piano and daddy singing. And I used to enjoy the vibes of my mother when she was playing the piano, the vibrations. We had a wooden floor, very much as you have here now. And you'll be able to not only hear mum play, but feel the vibrations of sound through the wood. As a child, of course, I'd hide under the piano and feel my mum's vibes.
Okay. How about watching you, not as a child, but a more recent recording, playing something classical? What should we watch?
Maybe something classical like Liszt. You might would be quite nice to listen to, if you like.
Let's do that.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful, beautiful. But classical music is not your only passion. You have kind of enhanced on your repertoire, I suppose.
Yes.
Tell me about your other passions in terms of music.
Oh, I love singing chansons françaises. I love French songs very much. Mean a lot to me. And also singing English as well.
Right. Do you feel Are you equally, you're bilingual, right?
Yes.
Do you feel more French or more British, or are you equally comfortable in both cultures?
It depends where I am, actually. When I'm in France, I feel more French, and here, definitely more.
Okay. You seem to always think about kind of things combined together. We will get to talk about chess and the involvement of music and chess, but even just pure music, I heard you talk about the sort of the highs and lows of music as a sort of analogy for the highs of and lows of life.
Yes.
How strongly do you feel it, and how much do you want other people to feel it, to basically identify with the music in terms of their life?
Well, in simple terms, music heals. And I think it's important if you can work out how to find harmony in your life. There's discord and there's accord, things that agree. And finding the harmony in humanity, finding some way of healing through listening to sounds, listening to things that please you, is a way of healing.
Okay. How about listening to some chanson of yours? Did I pronounce it?
Perfect.
Thank you. Tell me, what are we going to listen to now?
Comme d'habitude, which is actually a song that Paul Anka bought, and Frank Sinatra called it My Way, but originally it was French.
Comme d'habitude, toute la journée, je vais jouer à faire semblant. Comme d'habitude, je vais sourire. Comme d'habitude, je vais même rire. Comme d'habitude.
Comme d'habitude.
Exactement.
Do you remember, you probably remember Richard Clayderman, right?
Oh, yes.
Right. So my grandmother and I used to sit on the sofa and watch him with these amazing eyes of his playing the piano and kind of really looking at the television, knowing very well what he was doing. Yes. With this beautiful gaze of his. That gaze of his was very much showbiz.
Hmm.
Let's see how honest you are with your answer, how genuine you are with your link to people, and how aware are you of the sort of showbiz that you might create with your kind of charming the audience?
Well, I think with classical music, you have to be much more sincere. There's less room for showbiz in classical. You have to stay true to the composer. As far as performing other more modern songs, it's part of telling a story, and that's really about communicating and connecting with the audience.
Right. One of the manifestations of your passion was your, showing your lack of pleasure of the fact that the shop Harrods decided some 10 years ago to close their piano section.
Yes.
Why did you feel so strongly about it?
Well, I just imagined all these mothers taking their children to go shopping in Harrods, and just wandering up to the fourth floor where the piano department used to be, and just listening to music, something that a child could be inspired by, listening to music coming from the fourth floor. And suddenly, one fell swoop, just to stop having music, was very strange for me.
Right, okay. And so did you campaign a little bit?
I campaigned with Julian Lloyd Webber. We got together and we formed a campaign against closure. So we managed to delay it, but unfortunately, Harrods still went with what they wanted to do. Okay. Yes.
And at some stage you said, oh, this is appalling. They're turning into a bazaar.
Yes,
rather
yes.
than, right.
Yes, I don't think Harrods would be so happy with that. But there you go, that's what we thought.
Okay.
Yes.
But you say, you know, you imagined all these parents taking their children. Not many parents take their children to Harrods, okay, and it's a particular group of people, I suppose, who would. But it is very important for you to inspire young people, and presumably not only those who happen to be taken to Harrods, in terms of enhancing their skills, life skills, mental health. You are trying to reach young people, and you do that through the game of chess.
Yeah.
So you play yourself,
yes.
And you compete sometimes.
Yes.
But it's not just that. You have an agenda, and that's to spread the word, really. And you've done quite a number of things to get the game popular particularly with children and young people and young women.
Yes.
What is it about the young women that they or girls that don't seem as enthusiastic about the game as boys?
Well, I think they maybe lose interest after 11. I realized when I had the giant chess sets in Holland Park and also in Edinburgh, that a lot of the time their brothers would sideline their sisters, did not want to play with their sisters. So I decided to create an idea that chess is not only a battle, it's also a ballet, a way of moving, movement across the board, the choreography of the pieces. And that seems to have gone down very well with girls to come into chess as a way of coming in.
We're going to take a break now, but after the break, we'll see a little bit of your campaigning for chess and young women. Welcome back to Extraordinary People. With me is Jason Kouchak. Jason, just before the break, we touched upon your involvement with chess and promoting it to young people, young women in particular. And that's really part of your project, The Queen's Journey.
That's right.
Let's watch a little bit of what it entails.
Thank you.
What are we going to watch?
We're going to watch a ballet performance on the chessboard in Holland Park.
Right. You have been given a title, I'm going to read that title, Ambassador of Artistic Values of Chess. The other person who has that title is Yoko Ono, I believe.
Yes.
Right. It's quite obvious that apart from your passion to music and to chess, you're very much into the aesthetics of the whole thing. What came first, this particular title or your genuine love for the aesthetics of the whole thing, you know, the ballet, the performance, the giant, you know, chess set, etc.?
Yes, I think I've always loved the aesthetics, the energy within a framework. So the framework, of course, being the chessboard, or the framework being the keyboard, but having the ability to create energy fields within that framework. So it's a combination of both.
Right. And you use some of your friends to create that hype, I suppose.
Yes.
Tell me about that.
Well, Judith Polgar, I saw Queen's Gambit. Netflix.
So she Judith Polgar was she the inspiration for the Queen's Gambit?
Yes. Uh-huh. So it was great to work with her because she does a wonderful festival each year, and it was a way of connecting with the choir and ballet. Chess connects with music. So it was really wonderful to be part of the festival there because she also loves music and I love chess.
Right, right. Have you had any kind of tangible successes, I suppose? People who came to you and said, thank you, because of your, or thanks to your music or your promotion of chess, my life has changed in some way.
Yes, very much so. I met people in New York, did a Queen's Journey performance in Westchester, outside New York, and the mothers came up to me saying how their girls had actually evolved and blossomed by having chess in their lives, more confidence, finding their core, which was a great compliment to me.
Because in some ways you say, you know, chess is very much like real life. Am I someone who dares? Am I someone who stays? Am I going to go this way?
Yes.
Am I going to go that way?
Yes.
Is that how you promote the game? I mean, are you quite out there in your message to the young people?
Very much so. There's always options, opportunities, chances, challenges. And what I say to people who play chess, as well as musicians that I work with, I say there's always finding the core within the word recovery. The first four letters of recovery is the word core, but just an acronym of it, to have a strong core. Strong confidence.
Right. Talking about strong core, Jackie Chan.
Yes.
He inspired you, right?
Well, yes, because it was such a compliment. I was in Hong Kong during the handover, and it was just a compliment. He was there for a performance I was giving, and I realized he was there because he was learning about the Western movements, the ballet movements, and I think in order to incorporate within his own movies.
And Patty Boyd is another friend.
Yes, Patty Boyd's lovely. I played at her third wedding, married to Rod. So I was Rod's piano teacher. I ended up being Rod's piano teacher and then Patty's chess teacher on the giant chess set. And what a wonderful lady she is to have these two amazing songs written for her by George Harrison and Eric Clapton. So yes. It's a great compliment.
Yes. And she took part, you also performed with her, well, kind of mucked about, I suppose, on the chessboard.
Yes, it was wonderful. And she learned so quickly. And she loves chess. So it's just such a compliment.
Right. Mental health of young people. You're obviously aware that there are a lot of issues and your messages are very much about kind of resilience and strength and taking the right moves. And one of your songs that you in fact recorded in Sussex,
yes,
is more or less about that. Tell me about the song and about the message that it conveys, and then we will watch a little bit of it.
Thank you. This is a song about a young man who is walking beside the coast, Winchelsea and Camber Sands, and looking for a meaning in his life. And at a certain point, as he's walking and looks towards the horizon, he realizes that it's a critical moment where he can either break down or break through. So this is a song which is a very strong message because it is that point in time which everybody, I think, maybe goes through, where you decide whether to recover or whether to give up. So in this song, it's I had it all and let it go, but he does recover.
Let's watch a little bit of that.
I want the feeling like before, but I can't love anymore. What's left to look forward to? I'm calling out, I reach
for. What about you? Tell me perhaps about your own experience of low points that perhaps give you the confidence and maybe the authority to give positive messages to others.
For me, I use the tools of nature and of the notes. So when I play the piano, I take the frequencies from chord structures, from melodic structures, and I try to self-heal. I'm lucky in the way that I have the tools in order to self-heal through the darkness, through the black and white notes. Looking at the keyboard itself, there are black notes and there are white notes. Looking at a chessboard, there are black squares and there are white squares. In order to reach white notes, maybe you have to go through the black notes.
And have these things helped you personally in your dark squares in your life?
Yes, very much so. I mean, I'm an only child, and I always wanted to have brothers or sisters. So I found having a world in chess or having a melodic structure and a world in music helped me to heal myself, to have the tools to find my own core, because I didn't have brothers or sisters to bounce off, to ask, could you help me through this? So I was very lucky. And that's one thing I must say that I recommend that every mum and dad persuades their child to try to take up an instrument, because that will help them in later life.
Right. Does it still help you? Does it still heal you?
Oh, yes. I'm laughing at things I play. I laugh at myself and I think, and this is a very amazing way of healing, of not actually needing to bounce off anyone, to bounce and have the reverberation and the resonance, the frequencies given back to you. What you put in, you get back. And it's just lovely. And even sad songs, you can also cry out. You can release and you can recover.
Do you cry?
Oh, I love crying in order to cry out.
Right.
I always feel if you have a good cry, it's a bit like turning your computer off or putting it on standby. You'll come back refreshed and rebooted.
Mm-hmm. You know? Tell me a little bit about you had some involvement with a film with Dustin. Well, Dustin Hoffman was the director.
Yes.
And you orchestrated the music. You didn't write the music.
No.
But you orchestrated. Tell me a little bit about the film and what it actually entailed and how was the experience?
It was great to work with Dario. I did a piano piece. Unfortunately, it actually was not used in the movie, in the final cut.
Right.
But it was great to work with him.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Any inspiration there?
Yes, inspiration from Michael Gambon, because Michael told me this wonderful story during film breaks. He said that when he was a young actor, he was at across the National Theatre, and the director said, "Will you meet me at Savoy? Let's have a drink at Savoy. Let's celebrate your first night." And he was there early, and there was a man playing the piano at the Savoy Hotel. So of course, being a young actor, Michael Gambon sits beside the piano and just waits, you know, for the director to come to buy the drinks at Savoy Hotel. And it's a pianist playing, and Michael Gambon says, "You're rather good." And it turns out to be Horowitz.
Rather good. Yes. Oh, that's nice. You have a lot of ideas. Yes. You've recently been involved more locally to us with Lewis FC.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about that.
Well, I felt that they're such a wonderful football team. And in fact, I just played recently in the quarterfinals, and it was just great to see them. I've given a chess set to them in the color of their strip, black and red, to inspire them before games, so they can visualize the use of spatial, visual, and lines before they actually go on the pitch themselves. They have their own little chess pitch.
Right, yes. Right. And one more thing before we go, talking about giving chess sets, you have an idea for Brighton Festival.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about that.
Well, I'd like to have a marine chess set because, of course, just nearby, the dolphins used to be here at the aquarium. So the idea is to have a giant chess set, blue and white colors, dolphins as pawns, octopus, rooks, seahorses as knights, King Neptune, of course, a mermaid, a queen mermaid as the queen.
Lovely. So something to look forward to perhaps in the next year or two at Brighton Film Festival.
Yes.
Brighton Festival, rather.
Yes.
Thank you so much for being my guest on Extraordinary People, Jason.
Thank you for having me. Thanks so much.